Hi creatives, today we're designing a brand from scratch, and I do have to say it didn't turn out exactly like I thought it would. This is part 4 of me sharing my full design process for branding, and in the previous episodes we looked at how to set up proposals, contracts, how to do research and mood boards, and today we're going to look at concepting. You voted for this mood board in our community, so thank you so much for voting. So today's design will be based on botanicals and nature for the brand that is a community garden called Rootful. My first step when I create concepts is to try to look at the mood board and free associate ideas that I could think of that might be appropriate for the brand. In this case, I was thinking about these beautiful garden gates that have really ornate designs and how maybe we can create a design for a logo icon with a simple version of these. I like it because a door feels very inviting and it would be a really good way to bring in leaves and flowers in the icon. I use sites like Pinterest, Unsplash and Pexels to find reference images, and I add it all into Mila notes so that I can refer back to it when I sketch. I'm also going to create illustrations that are a lot more realistic today, so I'm going to take you through how to do that, and I want to have images that I can use as reference, and I really do want to consider copyright here. I always use images that I have rights to when I use them as reference, like through Envato licenses or a site like Unsplash, just to make sure I'm not infringing on anyone's copyright. Okay, great, so now we have our different references, and I'm going to start sketching ideas for my logos. I work in Procreate because that's where I illustrate and I'm really comfortable, but if you prefer, you can sketch on pen and paper, or even in Illustrator if that's something you're comfortable with. I try to not get too stuck on one idea, so I started working on the different layouts for the door, but then I always want to try out other ideas, like maybe creating a handwritten word mark, for example. Since we want this urban garden to feel very inviting and friendly, I think maybe a more hand-lettered word mark could work really well. Try to focus on where in the word that you have empty space. Like in this one, you have space above the O's because the capital R and the T are both higher up. And then see if you can add in details or customize the letters to create a more balanced design. I also have this idea of a few vegetables or maybe flowers coming together to create more of like a stamp effect. Kind of like what you would see if you would use linocut or stamp as a design. It brings a bit more texture and I think it could work really well with this more organic design style. My problem here is that it's just not very visible at small sizes, so I need to find a way to make the design much clearer and maybe a little bit simpler, but I don't want to lose the personality. Okay, so I have an idea. I want to see if we can use the flower that I quite like and maybe combine it with a shovel to create an icon. Okay, I do really like that, and I think this might be the direction that we're going to go in. It could be a hint that the work that you put into the garden helps you flourish and makes your community better. Before I finalize the mark, I want to try a few different flower designs, and I think this one with the more pointy ends works best. My last step before I move to Illustrator is just to clean up the design so it's easier for me to create a vector from, and I also want to make sure that I create a solid version so that I can just make sure that the idea still works. Perfect, so now that we have our concept, I want to move into Adobe Illustrator and create a vector version, and that's just so that the logo can be scaled infinitely without becoming pixelated. In Illustrator, I try to use the Shape Builder tool and the Pathfinder to break my design into geometrical shapes and then customize them by adding or subtracting parts. I feel like this makes it easier to be precise rather than if I would use the pen tool, because I can just never make a circle as perfect as the circle tool. You kind of have to try your way forward here and just make sure that your logo is visible at small sizes so you can zoom in and out. Just make sure that all your lines and negative space tend to be kind of similar so that it feels really balanced and you don't have one area that's super thin and some that are super thick. When you have different shapes that overlap, it can be quite helpful to use Command Y to show the outlines of your shapes, and then when you want to go back, you just click Command Y again. Just keep tweaking your design, and sometimes it can be a really good idea to just take a break, get a bit of a fresh perspective, and then come back and see, okay, is it balanced? What can I improve? What can I tweak? Before I move forward, I want to check to make sure there's not another logo design that already exists that looks super similar to what I've just created. So I use a database called Weepo Global Brand Database, and here you can search for logos that look similar by just uploading your own image. It's kind of like TinEye, but for copyright. I can't see anything similar, so let's continue. Next up, I want to find a font that will work well with my icon. In some cases where I'm not sure if I will have an icon, I might start with a typeface, but in this case, I felt like the icon would guide the design. I usually start with the fonts I've already installed because they tend to be the ones that work well and that I've kind of pre-vetted before. In this case, I'm thinking that we want a serif, maybe display font, with a lot of character. If we choose a sans serif, I think the logo could feel a bit too like hipster or modern, but we need it to be a little bit of a heavier weight to work well with the mark, so it doesn't feel unbalanced. I'm not quite finding what I want from my library, so I'm looking on Envato Elements, and I actually think I found a font that could work really well for like the small text that goes around a badge and for little details. If we look back to the mood board, having these badges and kind of a more retro style was a big element, so I do want to give that a try. Okay, yeah, I do really like that. I think many of these retro typefaces have kind of a heavy hand texture, but that could make it quite hard to read at small sizes, and I also don't want it to feel too retro, so I'm going to use a solid version. I also found a font that I really like for the word mark. I have an idea to connect the T and the F, so I'm going to give that a try, because at this stage I'm just trying things out and seeing what works best. I actually won't finish this one because I think it just becomes too complicated and the line is a little bit too thin, but it was worth a try. I always put all of my little experiments as a small version up in the top corner of my board, so I can always come back to them if maybe I have an idea later or I think of a way to maybe tweak them. So I would say never delete things that you've tried, because you never know if you want to use them. So now that we have the icon, the stamp and the wordmark, I want to start building out the different lockups of the logo and the slogan, and I'm noticing that the text in the circle, it feels a little bit dense, and it means that it's a bit competing with the wordmark, and it's a bit harder to read. I'm going to try to make the tracking, so the space between all the letters, much wider, and that way we'll be able to make the text a bit smaller, but still cover the same area. That looks a lot better, so I'm going to apply that to the stamp as well. Okay, nice, so now we can create the lockup and then we can move on to colors. Since I picked out these colors for the mood board and they're not taking from another brand, I like to use them as a starting point. But I do feel a bit like this green might be a bit too dark and maybe it gives a bit too much of a serious feeling. I do like the coral and the beige, but I think the yellow also needs to be adjusted a little bit. The last thing before we move on to the illustration is to look at photography. And photography, I think, can really make or break the brand, especially when you present it to your client. I think having their new logo on a photo that gives the right feeling can really bring home a design when you're presenting it. Okay, so now let's have a look at how to create a more realistic illustration. I'm going to share a time lapse of my Procreate illustration, and I'm going to talk you through it so you can see every step that I go through and every pencil brush stroke. I want to draw this pea pod because it has a really nice green color that I think will work really well with the brand. You can see the reference image that I've put up in the top corner, and I try to break it into basic shapes as I draw and look at what shapes I can see rather than assume what they should look like. So for example, the peas are actually quite square rather than round because they all have to fit into that pod, so they've all been a bit squeezed. I start with the base color and then I add shadows and lighting, and you really have to hang in there and trust the process because it always looks quite terrible in the beginning. Just keep looking at where the shadows and the light is and add and remove as you go. I like to put everything on its own layer so that I can make a shadow more or less intense with opacity rather than having to redo a whole section. So here it is, it's a pea pod. So let's start using it in our design. I think it would be nice to create a section on the website to talk about growing your own food, and I think the illustration works really nicely with the font as well. The black text is a little bit harsh, so I'm going to use a green text instead to create a bit more of a friendly feeling. I also wanted to show that even if you're not an illustrator and you work as a brand designer and want to use illustration, there are so many good stock illustrations that you can use, so I'm going to work with some of those as well in this video. Another great tip if you're a brand designer and you don't illustrate is to team up with an illustrator and create a joint process. I think it's a really good way to get more work as well because you can both bring projects to each other and it's really fun to collaborate. I also want to finalize my fonts, and I think it's really important to have a font for the main text that is really easy to read. We want to keep in mind people have maybe a form of colorblindness or maybe not see as well as other people, so the text should be really visible. Now comes a really fun part. I'm going to start applying the visual language to create Instagram posts as a way to show my client how this brand can be applied, because the practical application would be a really big decision factor for them. I quite like the idea of having an image treatment that feels a bit like scrapbooking because it fits nicely with the mood board, but it also feels a bit like you're making memories. At this point, if you feel like it's easy to design, that usually means that you have a clear brand and that all of your fonts and colors work well together. If you're finding it hard to use, have a think about what changes that you can make to the brand assets so it will be easy for both you and the client to apply the brand in the future. So here is the Rootful brand. I had so much fun creating this brand, and I would love to hear from you if you want to see more work on illustration here. Next time, we're going to wrap up this series with how to present your work to clients, how to create the brand guide, and finally the handoff to your client to make sure that you can have an ongoing, really good relationship with them. It's going to be super packed full of tips, so if you're not already subscribed, make sure you subscribe so you can see when that video comes out. Thank you so much for watching. Good luck with your projects, and see you next time.